Hello and welcome to UAT Time within the United Countries Special by First Ukraine. You can find us on the frequencies available on our website, firstua.com. I'm Sergei Velichansky.
And I am Olivier Drin. UAT Time is dedicated to bring Ukraine and Europe closer to each other by introducing the real Ukraine to the rest of the world.
There are many things that have happened in the past few weeks that have a chance to have lasting effect on the whole world. We can't stay away from them, and we'll do our best to analyze the events that we think are the ones that have a great impact on Ukraine.
Our guest today is Paul Nyland, a longtime Kiev resident and Kiev Post contributor.
Welcome back.
Thanks for inviting me again.
Yes. Last time it was fun, but today we've invited you because of, because of your latest article in Kyiv Post.
Okay.
About the legitimacy, but pretty much that brings us to the question about the latest Maidan anniversary. Mm-hmm. It's been 2 years, and did you go to the to Maidan this past week?
No, I didn't.
For the concert?
I didn't actually, because I wasn't in Kyiv.
Okay.
If I'd been in Kyiv, then I certainly would have gone. And it's important to point out that the anniversary that we just saw was the second anniversary of the start of Maidan. Mm-hmm. The second anniversary of the end of Maidan will be in 3 months.
Yes.
Right? Because that's, you know, when people try to distort the reality of what we went through, they try and create an impression that it was a sudden thing, that it just happened, that it was this coup or mob that just stood up one day. It wasn't. It was 3 months of a lot of hard work and cold, long days and a lot of effort to make our point. And when I was away, it was interesting to watch from afar, and I think it's very important actually that we all take a step back sometimes so that we can get a better perspective on what happens in Ukraine, to not be actively involved in it every single day, just to step back and just to see from another point of view.
My question for the two of you, do you think, is that a good idea to celebrate such a thing as the start of Maidan? Supposedly, they're trying to make it as a pattern for the future generations. But is that a good idea?
Okay, I think yes, it is a good idea. I think the word celebrate is wrong, and I think that was, from what I read, that was the objection that some people on Maidan had, that this shouldn't be a celebration. 100 people died, you need to commemorate that. You need to remember that. You need to observe that.
Okay,
but to celebrate it and turn it into a pop concert, it's poor taste.
I think I prefer to do a commemoration, to commemorate Maidan, like we do in France for the 14th of July, the French Revolution.
Yeah.
And we have one day, and we do the commemoration of during this day. And I think I think that would be the same. I think that would be good to do the same.
Because, well, here's my observation is that we will definitely do some commemorational events at the end of February. That's for sure, because of so many people died.
Yeah.
My question was, why do we need one for the beginning? Especially that we, you know, a lot of people have different ideas of the when it all started the real start. Mm. You know, whether it's before the December 1st, you know, of that bloody night. Or that is the beginning, you know.
But then I think we have the same issue potentially if we look at what happened at the end of February. Okay, so the 22nd of February is the date that we can say that the revolution won, because that's when Yanukovych fled.
Yes.
But then very, very close to that as well, we have the 27th of February, which is when Russia's military operation in Crimea began to seize the peninsula.
Yeah.
So if we're celebrating one, then, you know, we have to be mindful of the other at the same time.
Yeah.
When did the revolution start? The revolution certainly started on the 21st of November. That was when people started to gather. The 24th of November, there was a big demonstration on European Square. There were a lot of people out then. But really, for me, the 30th of November, when the night riot police beat up those kids and everybody stood the next day on Mikhailovsky, That was an important day for me, because when we were standing on Mikhailovsky, all the cars that were driving by, every single one was beeping their horn, and waving. And I knew then that actually what had started was a revolution. And then the next day, when there were a million people on the street, it was confirmed that that's exactly what was going
on. For me, this is really also the 30th of November, the beginning.
Yeah. Well, what I'm trying to say is that before the 30th of November, it was a meeting.
Yeah.
But the revolution, or the, you know, the meeting started taking on the shape of revolution after the 30th.
The 30th of November and the 1st of December.
Like this,
But the dates on a calendar, really. I think what we should be commemorating, and you can pick whatever date. What we should be commemorating is the victory of the Ukrainian people over that system of kleptocracy, autocracy, dictatorship that was creeping on us, and defeating corruption. And I think everything that's happened since then, really, the reason why Russia has reacted so negatively to events in Ukraine, I mean, is because the Ukrainian people simply stood up and defeated a corrupt regime. And Vladimir Putin cannot allow that message to be understood in such a simple and plain way by the people of Russia, for obvious reasons, right?
But
here's the thing, we have covered this a lot of times, but what we really face right now, that discouragement of a lot of people with the results of revolution.
Yeah.
And that's what happened at that evening when supposedly the celebrational concert for the, you know, Maidan anniversary should have taken place, but it never did because the people, the people didn't like the idea, and they pretty much blockaded the concert.
And I was, although I wasn't in Kiev, I was observing from afar, and I saw lots of people talking about a protest that was happening out on Bankova Street outside the presidential administration, and people were tweeting this, and I answered, I said, I've been away from Kiev for 6 days. What's fundamentally changed in 6 days? That was not what happened on Bankova that night. That was not going to be the start of another revolution. Yeah. And the first thing I did when I came back to Kiev was I walked through Maidan. The normal Maidan, the normal situation. I walked up to Bankova, there's nobody there. And then, interestingly, I walked around to the cabinet of ministers. Mm-hmm. And what I've seen, yes, there are a lot of people after the revolution who are not satisfied with the pace of change. They think it should be faster. They want more to happen. And I agree with them. We desperately need judicial reform. We desperately need to handle the situation with the Prosecutor General's office. But these pop-up protests that we keep seeing that really don't have any momentum behind them, but are great news footage for RT and for the Russian domestic news channels to show Ukraine in some kind of, you know, Kiev's in disarray and people are protesting again.
Yeah.
It's nonsense, and it's and yes, people can protest and should protest.
Yeah.
But when I arrived outside the cabinet of ministers and I was there 10 days before and there were people banging oil drums, trying to recreate the spirit of Maidan, and they had all these tents with the names of the cities apparently where people were from. It was just nonsense. There were a couple of dozen people standing around. In the park opposite, there were rent-a-babushki. Yeah. And when I went a few days ago after I returned to Kiev, it's almost completely stopped. It's as fast as it started, it's gone away. And this kind of pop-up protest needs to be addressed. This is people that are playing with the democratic process and playing with the democratic freedoms that exist in Ukraine right now for their own political ends, rather than for the good of the country, which is where we should be focused, right?
Yes, because when it comes to systematic groundwork for the reforms, it doesn't happen. Today, the final day of a parliament session, 25 parliament members showed up.
No.
For the session. I mean, I saw the picture. I mean, maybe it was in the morning, maybe they came later, but the morning session, like maximum 25 people showed up for the session. What are we, you know, what are we talking about? Yes, they are working for the cameras, they're working for the PR, for their own populistic statements, but in reality, I mean, some major bills that should have been discussed and hopefully passed will have to be postponed till December 8th, when the final session gets back. Now,
yeah, for me, we have a problem in Ukraine. It's a problem of the education of the elite of Ukraine. And
I like the hanging quote you did.
Elite.
Elite deserves that.
Pseudo elite well, for me,
here,
but
here,
elite.
Yeah.
You know, in European Union, our elite, I don't like this word, our elite, they have the sense, the way of thinking of the state. Mm-hmm. They know they are here to serve the state. Mm-hmm. And I think this is the problem in Ukraine. You don't have this education to serve the state. And very few have this education. The new generation, they will have, and they have this education. But the old generation, they are like, I can say, civil servants for their own interest.
Well, in Ukraine, everybody knows if you really want to become rich, become a parliament member.
And in France, it's impossible. Yeah. I think also in your countries, it's impossible, you know.
Yeah.
Impossible. And I want to talk about the sense of the state. You have to serve your state.
But when you say, when you say in my country it's impossible, I grew up in the UK. Mm-hmm. And in the UK about 15 years ago, there was a big scandal, maybe 12 years ago, there was a big scandal about MPs' expenses. Mm-hmm. And members of parliament had been fiddling their expenses reports mm-hmm. to the tune of one person had taken like, you know, £2,000 more than mm-hmm. he was entitled to. Another person had overclaimed for like £24,000. Like, that's a scandal.
Yeah.
In a developed democratic society, that level of dishonesty from an elected member of the National Assembly, that is a scandal.
Yeah.
And we're not even talking about people that are driving. I saw yesterday with a Verkhovnaya Rada number plate, a Mercedes S63 AMG V8 biturbo. Now, I don't know how much that car costs exactly, but it's $120,000, $150,000, I would guess, right?
But you know. But
he's not ashamed of it, right?
You know, in European Union, in UK or in France, you have only, if you want to change this country, you have only to do one law. One law.
Which is?
Which is how, from where your income come from.
Which in theory they have. They're all
and
supposed
you,
yeah, to you, demonstrate. Yeah,
yes,
they're supposed
you have
to demonstrate
to prove
their income.
If right. you cannot prove you are guilty.
Yeah.
And in Ukraine, like in Russia, mm-hmm. that's the administration to prove that you are guilty. In France, you have to prove that you are innocent.
No, but in, here's another thing. To implement that law, you need to have a law of justice system of justice reformation, because you have corrupted prosecutors that are not gonna start open the case against you if you use the same money that you mentioned just as a pocket money for the daily expenses.
You're exactly right, and we've come full circle back to the question about reforming the judiciary and about the Prosecutor General's office. But I think actually it goes back further to what Olivier was saying earlier on. What is the title that a member of parliament has in Ukraine? Narodny deputat.
Yeah.
A people's deputy.
Yeah.
And the issue is a lack of understanding. I wouldn't say an education, it's a lack of understanding that actually their job is supposed to be that they are Narodny, they are the people's deputies.
But do you know one of the battles right now that is taking place? I mean, mm-hmm. The civil service reform, mm-hmm. it's been in and out. We had Denis Brodsky mentioning about this in early August.
Yeah.
It's still, the fights are still going, and December 8th, that's when the votes will supposedly, hopefully, will take place. But they should have taken place today, mm-hmm. but they again postponed it. So the government, the prime minister and the cabinet of ministry is sabotaging it. I mean, that's where a completely a new reformation of the government offices, mm-hmm. the status of the deputies and all the will be reshaped completely.
I've heard this. I've heard about allegations of there being sabotage of civil service reform here, and we can speculate why. But where actually Ukraine it really benefits is it benefits from the political will from outside at the moment, and the European Union are particularly interested in civil service reform, and are making great strides at the moment towards helping with this reform and helping with the redevelopment of the civil service. I mean, you can draw an easy formula and you can say that the bureaucracy is four times or five times overstaffed. So if you sack 80% of them, then you can afford to give everybody a four times pay rise, and you remove the incentive for them then to be taking bribes just for doing their job. But as well as the easy maths, you need someone to help guide with that process. And Ukraine's getting a lot of help right now from European partners. Yeah. And fortunately, because we need it.
Well, here's the thing. As far as the civil service, I mean, there is a lot of issues that we can talk, but I want to come back to something interesting that took place recently. Mm-hmm. Blacking out of Crimea?
It's a very touchy subject, isn't it?
Yeah.
Again?
Basically, let me recap. The volunteers took down the high voltage electrical posts.
Power lines, yeah.
Power lines.
Pylons, yeah.
Yeah. So it's been, what, several days now?
Yeah, several
that
days, yes.
Crimea mm-hmm. ended up mm-hmm. without any power. Mm-hmm. So there is a lot of speculations there, but pretty much that's the fact. Now, what do you think about that? And it's action by the people, volunteers, right? Supposedly there is some contracts from the government with Crimea, which is still a question. And you know, why in the world we have been supplying power for the 2 years to the occupied territory? But the people decided, there is quite a few Tatars there, mm-hmm. Crimean Tatars. They decided, we are fed up with this, we want to stop it. And now what's happening is then the Ukrenergo, the company that's responsible for this, they started the maintenance work mm-hmm. to fix it up. Mm-hmm. But today's information that they stopped the work because the activists, the volunteers, demanded to stop it because they want to exchange the power back to Crimea for the political prisoners from Russia. Here's the situation.
This is totally normal, you know, because a large part of the people are fed up about the situation. And this is totally normal because of Maidan, a civil society in Ukraine is growing, mm-hmm. and this is really the result of the growing of the civil society. Okay. The people want to take in their own hands their destiny, and this is very important. Yes, this is a provocation. Of course, they are guilty because they don't have to do that. But I understand. Come on, okay. the Crimea annexion, criminal annexion of Crimea. Everybody talk, the European talk, US talk, everybody talk, and they are waiting for something. And now they are fed up.
Okay.
Again, this is something that happened while I was away. And my first reaction when I saw this, I'm not convinced that it was the volunteers, the people that okay. are involved in the blockade okay. that actually did this. Because the first thing that I thought was that's just a gift for Russia's PR about the nationalists, about the extremists, about Ukrainians being cruel, about people not caring about Crimea and everything else. And since it's happened, I've seen, it's a very divisive debate. I've seen people talking about it on Twitter, and people are very firmly on one side or the other. My side, if I have a side, I'm a humanitarian. There are people that live there. Yeah. And there are people that, okay, so it has the most moderate climate in all of Ukraine, but it's still getting cold. We're still entering yeah. winter time, and there are people, there are normal families, relatives of friends of mine mm-hmm. who are sitting there right now, and they're sitting there in the dark, and they're sitting there without additional heating yeah. going on. We know that heating mm-hmm. is kind of a central system, but additional heating, that's wrong.
Yeah,
that's wrong. And if people want to talk about the supply contract between mainland Ukraine and the temporary occupied area of Crimea. If we've been supplying electricity down there for the last 2 years, if it's being paid for, then I don't really see why somebody would have a major objection to that.
Maybe this
if
is
it's being paid
maybe
for,
this
right?
is manipulation. Maybe.
I think it is.
Maybe, yes. But if this manipulation was successful, this is because something is going wrong. Mm-hmm. And which is going wrong?
Well, who owns Ukrenergo is making good
money. I agree with you. The result is that the Russian propaganda is very good for the Russian propaganda.
The Russian propaganda gets a boost, and the people, really, and that's they're the most important thing.
But at
the
people in Ukraine...
The people there, the residents of Crimea, are suffering. Yeah.
Yes, totally agree. That's why I say they are guilty, even if I understand them, they are guilty to destroy those people. They are guilty, for me, humanitarian one things. We can understand that. They are waiting for result. The Ukrainian people are waiting for result.
Well, this is basically the consequences, as we just talked about, Maidan.
This is very easy to manipulate people who are waiting for something.
No results on the investigations, no visible results on reforms, and so people are getting tired, and so this, whether it's right or wrong, I mean, we're just humans, we can have our own opinions, but it's true, people are suffering in Crimea, that's obvious.
Can I just come back into one thing, though? You've just said no visible results on the reforms, and you said before that no arrests about Maidan. Yes, again, it's a question of the Prosecutor General's office not investigating fully those crimes or the crimes of the corrupt Yanukovych era theft of state resources. But when we say there are no visible results of the reforms, I disagree. And what I think is that the authorities do not enough to make them visible. We do have reform. Things are changing.
But that's why I use the word visible.
Visible. Visible is
the
question.
I know that reforms are taking place. We have quite, good guests coming, talking, sharing. It's true, but they're not visible.
They're not visible, and they're not being felt by and large by the average man on the street yet.
Exactly.
Because it takes time. But there's a very good resource, and in fact, I've been asked to write an article on this particular topic as well. Reforms, are they happening or not? But there's a very good resource from the Carnegie Endowment, which is monitoring and collating lists of all the reforms that we've gone through. And if anybody ever says to me there have been no reforms, then it's one link just to completely destroy that argument.
Okay. They did reform, but you are right. The communication.
Not enough and not fast enough and not telling people about it.
No communication. Yeah. Why?
Okay, real quick. We've got a couple of minutes left. Okay. But one of the major things that took place, which I think could turn around some interesting statuses in the world as far as the influence geopolitics. Downing of Su-24 by Turkish Air Force. Mm-hmm. It took place about 2 kilometers, that's when the Russian Air Force plane went into the territory of Turkey after about 10 warnings still being disobedient, the plane was shut down. So, what do you know? What do you think?
I think technically Turkey is absolutely right. Morally, you can see, in fact, that the Russians have a point. The Russians should not have been violating Turkish airspace, but the fact is that that plane crossed was for 17 seconds in Turkish airspace. 17 seconds is not the biggest violation that we've ever seen. It's rare that I would be on the side of Russia, and I'm not particularly on the side of Russia here, but they do have an argument. But the problem that they have, while they have an argument, is they don't have any credibility.
Yeah.
And Russia's initial response was, there were no warnings, we were not inside their territory. I'm sorry, but Russia has told so many lies, particularly over MH17, that nobody believes them anymore. They have no credibility. They can shout and complain as much as they like, but people just look at it as, what's their reputation, right? For a 17-second incursion, should the plane have been shot down? Technically, yes. Morally, it's a judgment call, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Nassim, I totally agree. We cannot believe. That's the problem. We cannot
their
believe.
Problem.
that this is their problem, yeah. But we cannot believe.
Now, no. Russia has announced...
This is the result of this propaganda.
Food embargo on Turkey. So, you know, and clothes this, and import.
This is totally stupid. They, yes. You know, they punish their own people, you know.
They punish their own people. When they announced the food embargo from the European Union, they started importing a lot more from Turkey. Now they're going to stop the imports from Turkey.
Yes.
But, again, this comes it comes back to their credibility. What's the reason why they are blocking the import of products from Turkey now? It's not just because they've simply said, you shot down our plane, we're not taking it. Mm-hmm. They came up with a nonsense excuse that it doesn't meet hygiene standards, right? The excuse of hygiene standards not being met very coincidentally comes after an incident far too often.
But
right?
then do you know that the Turkish convoy, humanitarian convoy, was bombarded and destroyed? And as a result, then the Russian base was attacked again, shelled and destroyed. So I think we can expect some back and forth things like this, and it may or may not escalate
in Donbass.
Well, Donbass is a different topic.
Yeah,
but what I'm saying
we have to do the link.
Can there be, a warfare between Russia and Turkey?
No.
A little more serious than just, here and there?
I think no.
I think that the kind of problems that they're going to be between Turkey and Russia are not going to be outright warfare. They're going to be dirty games that will be
dirty
played.
Dirty game.
That's what we're going to see.
But
when we talk about the bombing of a humanitarian convoy because people are considering that it's entering the territory of another country, let's consider that to be a precedent. We've had 47 convoys that have crossed over from Russia into Ukraine.
Yeah.
If Russia thinks it's okay to be bombing humanitarian convoys nowadays, well,
that's a good.
I'm not calling for a bombing of these convoys, but I am saying that it's a precedent that Russia is stating that is wrong.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, it's a lot of issues, but we have covered quite a few good topics. So thanks for coming.
Thank you again.
It's a pleasure. It was United Country UAT time by First Ukraine. Our guest was Paul Nyland, a longtime Kyiv resident and Kyiv Post contributor.
Olivier Durin and Sergei Verichansky were working for you in the studio. Stay with us and we'll show to you the real Ukraine.
Thank you for being with us. Have a good day and see you soon.